at this given time, money goes out the window. You're not playing for money anymore after April the 3rd. You're now playing for Lord Stanley.
It's a long-term goal. It starts off in September on cruddy ice when you feel rotten in training camp, and a lot of days this is what, in your mind's eye, keeps you going, and now we're here and it's time to play for it.
You know, no one remembers the finalists. Everybody remembers the Stanley Cup team, and that's it. Everybody remembers that winner, and no one remembers the loser.
30 years from now, I can go down with my son or my grandsons or whatever family I choose to be with. I can go down to the Hockey Hall of Fame and point to the cup, and, you know, hopefully we'll be on there.
A sea of champions. The 1989 Stanley Cup playoffs. Hockey is a game of emotion and intensity. And at no time of the year are those qualities more concentrated than in the ultimate environment of the Stanley Cup playoffs. From the opening rounds to the last game of the finals, the playoffs are hockey at its most dramatic. The road to the cup is a long one, but it is a road well worth traveling. The 1989 Stanley Cup playoffs began in early April, the start of an odyssey that would come to full flower in the month of May. Oh, what a journey it was. In the Smythe Division, the road to the cup began with the Flames taking on the Canucks as the Oilers squared off with the Kings. Divided loyalties as Edmonton and Los Angeles went face to face. That meant that Wayne Gretzky would take on his former teammates in the opening round. This was a battle of brother against brother, where the emotions were unremitting.
It's extremely hard playing against Wayne Gretzky, Mike Krusolinski, Marty McSorley, guys that we've achieved so many fabulous things in our lives, be it the Stanley Cups and the way we did it in previous years in a total team effort.
To a team that did what they did, and the team, not basically as the players, but management and everything, to make a trade, to trade us away. You want to give it back to them in a sense. You want to prove that they made a mistake.
The proof was on the line in Game 7. Trailing 3-1 in the series, the Kings had stormed back to tie. Now Game 7 would decide it all, and Wayne Gretzky set the tone.
Gretzky with McSorley. Gretzky, left side. Gretzky shoots and...
Gretzky's early tally was followed later by Chris Kontos' 8th playoff goal. A recent King, Kontos had spent most of the year in Switzerland. Finally, the man who began the scoring this night ended it.
Gretzky with an empty net. Gretzky, he shoots, he scores!
3 unanswered goals had broken the game wide open. The Kings were on their way to a 6-3 win. The Edmonton Oilers, the defending Stanley Cup winners, were eliminated in the first round. Come what may, hockey would have a new champion in 1989. In the other Smythe Division series, the Calgary Flames were hard-pressed by the Vancouver Canucks, a team that had finished the season 43 points behind the first-place Flames. But rookie Trevor Linden and the Canucks paid that no mind. Under coach Bob McCammon, Vancouver fully extended the Flames, not just to Game 7 at Calgary, but overtime of that 7th game. And it was in that nerve-wracking extra period that Mike Vernon asserted his status as a clutch goaltender in the NHL.
Here's Bradley controlling, beats the streak, oh, and a two-save! The save of the night for Mike Vernon! There's a chance for Spiel, moving in, looks, shoots, save! Made by Vernon! Back up the wing, it comes to Tandy. Blast one, oh, and that one snapped out of the air by Vernon!
Total exertion in a thrilling game that finally found its end just past the 19-minute mark.
That one hacked out of the air by Reinhardt, followed up by Poplinski, around in front, they score!
Joel Otto's goal gave Calgary the victory, but the Flames were well aware of how close they came to being burned.
When you dodge the bullet as close as we dodged it, thanks to Mike Vernon and a couple breaks and work, and a Vancouver team that was very, very determined in the playoffs in the second half, you get a very, very thankfulness that you're still alive and going, and you don't want it to happen again. You dodged it once, don't push your luck a second time.
The Kings may have had Stanley Cup on their minds as the Spite Division Finals got underway, but the hardened Flames swept through the next series, beating Los Angeles in every aspect of the game.
Here's Casper to center. He's checked there by Lou. Lou takes it away. Great job by the Flames. They're all over the Kings, outskating them, hitting them, taking the puck away.
The Flames countered Kings scoring threats like Gretzky and Nichols with a terrific tandem of their own, Joe Mullen and Doug Gilmore.
And Flames are knocked it away. Now Gilmore rolls up a little to Mullen, and he scores! Gilmore to Mullen, and those two guys have killed the Kings in this series.
Yes, the Kings were dead in four, outscored in those games 22-11. The Flames were division champs with a date set for the Campbell Conference Finals. There was a tough road through the Adams Division. The Canadiens matched against the Whalers and the Bruins against the Sabres. In 1988, the Bruins were Stanley Cup finalists, and the road back looked awfully hard as Buffalo opened the series with a shutout win turned in by Jacques Cloutier. But the Bruins soon changed course with Cam Neely leading the way.
Janney pokes it back in, has a big break here with Neely in front, goes behind the net to Neely, score! Neely from Janney!
Five goals from Neely helped the Bruins reel off four straight wins. Though the Sabres were undefeated against the Bruins during the regular season, a turned-around Boston club was now advancing. Meanwhile, the division-winning Montreal Canadiens outlasted Larry Plough and the Hartford Whalers as the Habs worked overtime to get it done.
Grudlin back in the toward the net. Richey shoots, he scores! Stephan Richey has won it for Montreal at 5:01 of overtime. Wetmore races for the puck, can't get it by Courtnell, he shoots, he scores! Ross Courtnell wins it at 15:12 of overtime.
Two overtime victories capped off a Montreal first-round sweep. The Canadiens were headed for a playoff rematch with Boston. Last year, Montreal lost a playoff series to Boston for the first time in 45 years. The Canadiens were determined to prevent a repeat as they looked to Patrick Waugh, the bottom line of the defense that allowed the fewest regular season goals. Try as Terry O'Reilly and his Bruins might, Waugh and the Canadiens prevailed.
Broken up, and a hiss. Sweeney in the save! Back to Neufeld, a shot. Neufeld almost tied it up. Away to Ray Bourque. Wrist shot. Beautiful!
Each win was by a one-goal margin as the series ended in five. Montreal was headed for the Wales Conference Finals. No ifs, ands, or buts. Now on to the Norris Division, where the Red Wings were facing the Blackhawks and the Blues were up against the North Stars. The opening notes of this division's tune came on the last night of the regular season. In Chicago, Troy Murray came up big in overtime against the Maple Leafs.
Would have done it for Chicago. Gill lost the puck. Troy Murray shoots. He scores!
With that stunning win, Chicago ousted Toronto for the division's final playoff spot. The Hawks had qualified in their 80th game of the year. Stanley Cup time underway in Detroit. A great occasion for everyone, except perhaps the Octopus. But Coach Mike Keenan's Blackhawks overcame the Red Wing omens by raising the level of their game. Chicago upset the division-leading Wings in six, thanks to many outstanding efforts. The Hawks seem to be coming together as they rallied around their goaltender, late-season acquisition Alain Chevrier. The St. Louis Blues began their playoff road against the North Stars. Like a number of other first-round winners, the Blues found overtime to be the right time. Led by the likes of Peter Zezel and Brett Hull, the Blues were on the beat, ousting the North Stars in just five games. But in the Norris Division Finals, St. Louis ran headlong into Chicago's Alain Chevrier, who continued to come to the fore. Chevrier was at his best in turning back the Blues' attack.
Here they come, though. Here's a shot and a save by Chevrier.
The shot. Aaron's behind. Kennedy shot. Chevrier is the save of the game.
Also in starring roles, Steve Barmer and Denny Savard, bringing down the Blues in five. The Amazing Hawks were on their way to the conference finals. Along the road in the Patrick Division, the Capitals matched up against the Flyers while the Penguins met the Rangers. New York entered its series against the Pittsburgh Penguins in a tumultuous state. Ranger GM Phil Esposito had fired coach Michel Bergeron 4 days before the playoffs began and now would coach the team himself. The move did not pay off as the Rangers did little right while the Penguins did little wrong. Appearing in the playoffs for the first time in 7 years, the Penguins made the most of it, crushing the Rangers in 4 straight games. This year, the Washington Capitals finished first in the Patrick Division for the first time ever. But as in past years, playoff success proved elusive. This time, the road was blocked by the fourth-place Philadelphia Flyers. In a close series, the difference was Ron Hextall, who not only made great saves, but history.
Hextall stops it. Slips
look out.
Down the ice.
He's got a chance.
It.
He's got a chance.
He's got it. Yeah. The first time ever it's happened in the playoffs. Ron Hextall.
Hextall's goal helped boost the upset-minded Flyers as they popped the caps in 6 hard-fought games. Next, the Flyers looked to tie up the Penguins in the Patrick Division Finals, but found it impossible to restrain Mario Lemieux for very long. In Game 5, Mario put on one of the most magnificent performances of the playoffs when he tied postseason records with 5 goals and 8 points. But throughout the series, the Flyers countered with a top gun of their own, sniper Tim Kerr, the man who puts the Philly offense in gear.
He's been the key to our power play all year, and you know, he's getting 2 and 3 people all over him all the whole playoffs in front of the net, but he's so strong, and you know, he got a couple clear shots, and when he gets a clear shot, he knows what to do with it.
Pass prop behind, gave it to Kerr. Quick shot, score! Tim Kerr on the power play! Kerr with a wrist shot, he scores! Trick in the first period of play.
Man, what a shot he's got. Tim Kerr. Oh, he just explodes when he shoots that puck.
This road would go the distance. Game 7 in Pittsburgh, where the Penguins hoped Mario would help them tee up the division title. But instead, the limelight fell on Ken Reggett, a surprise starter playing in place of an injured Ron Hextall and playing brilliantly. While Reggett held up his end, Captain Dave Poulin took care of the other. Poulin scored Philadelphia's 6th shorthanded goal of the playoffs as he and Mark Howe broke in on a 2-on-1. That tally proved to be the game and series winner as the veteran Flyers delivered a difficult lesson to a young Penguins club.
I think the Flyers proved that in the playoffs you need some guys that have been there before, and you know, we had a few players that were there before, but not enough, I guess.
Now the Flyers were moving on. The road had narrowed to 2 lanes, and on a headlong course in the battle for the Wales Conference Championship were the Canadiens and Flyers. In 1987, these same two hockey clubs met for the conference title, and the Flyers emerged with a 6-game victory. At the time, a hard loss for proud Montreal, but one that current Flyers coach Paul Holmgren would dearly love to see repeated. In Game 1, Chris Chelios put a crushing and controversial check on Brian Propp, temporarily sidelining one of the Flyers' leading goal scorers. Nevertheless, Philadelphia went on to win this game 3-1. With the loss came the end of goaltender Patrick Roy's 34-game unbeaten streak at the Montreal Forum. Ken Reggett and the Flyers were still on a playoff roll, but a turnabout transpired. In the next 3 games, dominant Canadian defense enabled the Habs offense to regain control.
Eslin around, they score! Spin the drive, he scores! A breakaway look, shoots, he scores! Fortnall hammers one, he scores!
The Canadiens stormed to 3 consecutive wins and looked to close out the series at home in Game 5. But in this contest, the Flyers stood a little taller. A 1-1 tie went into overtime, and the difference was Dave Poulin, playing despite broken bones in his foot.
Moves to the front. Murphy a drive. Alpha Smith. Poulin scores! Dave Poulin in sudden death overtime. It'll take another game back in Philadelphia.
At the Spectrum, the Flyers had a further shot at survival, but their hopes soon dwindled. Defenseman Chris Chelios, poorly regarded in Philadelphia, answered in the most effective way possible.
Here's Ganey moving in. The trailer is Chelios. He gives to him. Score! Chris Chelios!
That goal gave Montreal a 3-1 lead, Later, Ryan Walter made it 4-1. And though Philly soon added a second goal, any chance of a Flyer comeback ended with a breakdown of their discipline late in the game. The Canadiens were Wales Conference champs and on their way to the finals. On next to the Campbell Conference Championship, the Flames taking on the Blackhawks. What a contrast here. Calgary, who finished with 117 points, best overall, against surprising Chicago, whose 66 were the fewest of any postseason qualifier. From the opening faceoff of Game 1, Calgary controlled the tempo as the Flames defenseman keyed the attack.
Around the boards of Mullen, nice outlet to McCowan. Jamie McCowan against Bob Murray with a long shot. He scores! McCowan from the blue line, right between the legs of Chevrier. It's 1-0 Calgary.
Game 1 would end in a 3-0 shutout for Mike Vernon, his third of the playoffs. But if some people thought this series might be a mismatch, the Hawks had a response in Game 2 as they doused the Flames.
Over the line comes Larmer on right wing. The shot, he scores! Knocked it away from Natras. Gilbert centers. Savarchuk, he scores! Presley into Roddick. The center is in score! Thomas parked in front, catches in the power play. Chicago leads 3-0.
Three goals in 6 minutes lifted the Hawks to a 4-2 win. Clearly, this series would be no day at the beach for Calgary. As the scene shifted to Chicago, the two teams performed before the most boisterous fans in hockey. The intensity of the crowd was only exceeded by the physicality of the play as both sides went at each other with all they had. The Flames hung tough in Game 3, finally taking charge in the third period en route to a 5-2 win. Game 4 was a head-to-head struggle in which all the goals came on the power play. Dennis Savard opened the scoring in the second period. Calgary answered back with a similar goal from Doug Gilmore. That 1-1 tie went to overtime, and in sudden death, the Flames survived a shorthanded situation and then cashed in on a power play chance when Al MacInnis beat Chevrier to seal the victory. Now Calgary was riding high, up 3-1. The Flames were red hot and feeling awfully good. The Flames would find their way to the Stanley Cup Finals after Game 5, thanks to two goals from Joe Nieuwendyk. Disregarding a mouth injury, Nieuwendyk let his stick do the talking.
Moving up with it is Nieuwendyk, over the line, coming in on goal, he shoots, he scores! This could be the one that does it. Joe Nieuwendyk opened the scoring tonight, and here he is again, making it 3-1.
For the second time in their history, the Flames were champions of the Campbell Conference, but a greater challenge still lay ahead. The first three rounds of the 1989 Stanley Cup playoffs were a tableau of passions, a bold relief from exaltation to dejection, with all the emotions in between. Win or lose, no hockey player would have it any other way. Stanley Cup was now but a single path. In the championship final round, Canadians and Flames as the hockey world turned its eyes to Calgary, Alberta. In In Terry Crisp's practice before Game 1, as the Flames go through their paces, some attention is focused on All-Star defenseman Gary Suter, sidelined by a broken jaw. How much will the Flames feel his absence, especially on the power play against Montreal? Meanwhile, Canadiens rookie coach Pat Burns oversees his club. Burns took control of this veteran team in October. After a slow start, the Habs finished just 2 points behind the league-leading Flames in the overall standings. From the looks of things, it's an even matchup as Game 1 draws near.
I think both of these teams, not only did we chase each other for total points, but we were fighting 1-2 for the least goals against scored in the league. And I think the teams are well coached, and they have the players who can carry out the assignments that are given to them. Both teams, I would assume, base their game from their defense to their offense.
We know we've got a 50-50 chance of winning the Stanley Cup right now. And when you're this close, you don't want to let an opportunity like this get away. I remember at the beginning of my career, I was with Minnesota and we were in the finals. And we didn't have a desperate feeling against the Islanders. We felt that we were the team of the future. And if we didn't win that year, we'd be back the next year or the year after that, and our time would come. But it doesn't work out that way. And that team never made it back to the finals.
I think Montreal feels that we're not a very disciplined team. And I think they're incorrect in their assessment there. There was a reporter yesterday asked Terry about the lack of discipline that the Flames have shown. And I think if somebody has watched, especially our last two series, they'd see a team that has been as disciplined as any.
I think it's pretty even. I think it's just going to really come down to the work habits and the desire to win. And right now, you know, I feel that maybe we have more of a desire to win.
Desire and pride on the line as the National Hockey League 63rd Stanley Cup Championship begins. The Montreal Canadiens have won 23 cups, their most recent just 3 years before against the Calgary Flames, who still seek the first championship in their franchise history. The Canadiens and Flames were the only two teams in the league to allow fewer than 3 goals a game during the year, and everyone expects a tight-checking, low-scoring contest. But the first period of Game 1 explodes with action.
On the Calgary penalty, Morrison moving up. Canadiens get in with Richie. He scores! Richie! Gilmore on with Otto. Otto passes back to the line. Couldn't reach it.
Two goals from Al MacInnis put Calgary up 2-1. The second came as the Habs gave up a rare 3-on-1. Colin Patterson explains.
I think they had a feeling that they could break the game wide open then. And their defenseman just got caught up ice, and we fortunately stole the puck and away we went. And I think it was a big play for us. Instead, we come back and score.
Both teams still try to exploit the fast pace in the early going, looking to take advantage of any situation or opening. Still in the first period, the Canadiens quickly press up ice.
Here's a chance for Robinson all along. Centered it. They score! Canadiens have tied it.
4 goals just 10 minutes into the game. A surprising development from Coach Terry Crisp's point of view.
I don't know, as a coach, like I stand behind the bench and I imagine Pat Burns doing the same thing behind his bench and you're going zing, 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 zing. It's 2-2, you're in the game, supposedly defensive style club, you're thinking, is this going to be a 9-8 job for one of them or an 8-7 job for one of them? Then after that, you could just see them start to settle in and the two armies start to move it back and forth.
The two armies did settle in after the midway point of the first period as defense got the better of offense on both sides. In order to break the 2-2 stalemate, Terry Crisp knew what his club had to do. Minutes into the second period, the Flames find the net as rookie Theo Fleury guns one through the five hole. McCleary's goal has given Calgary a 3-2 lead. And the task of protecting that one-goal advantage falls most squarely on Flames goaltender Mike Vernon as Montreal spends the rest of the game pursuing the equalizer.
It is McPhee and Walter. Here's a shot from the line.
Vernon's equal to the task, and Calgary takes away a 3-2 Game 1 victory. Ultimately, the contest held true to expectations, the difference hinging on one goal and one goal only. A two-day break followed the opening game of the series, and by the time Game 2 rolled around, much analysis had been done. The Flames, for their part, were very mindful of their other finals appearance when they also took the opener against the Canadiens, only to lose the next four. Still, they were happy with their effort.
Well, the mood's great. You can feel the confidence, quiet confidence. And, you have to be careful of confidence and then becoming cocky. And at this point, we cannot afford to become cocky. And I think that's been a little problem of our team this year. Once we get things rolling really, really well and the team's playing outstanding and, you know, individuals are playing outstanding, we tend to get a little cocky.
Thinking back to 86, we had a similar set of circumstances where we had won the first game and lost the second game and ended up losing three more after that in a row. Momentum is a big part of this, and it would be much more to our advantage to go into Montreal two up than even, but we're prepared for any eventuality, and as I said, we're just looking for a solid 60 minutes, and I'm quite confident if we do that, we'll be right where we want to be.
For Game 2, the Canadiens wanted to be on the winning side of the final score. To do that, they knew they had to improve upon their play in Game 1.
The difference I felt in the game were the two groups of forwards on either team. I thought Calgary's team, their forwards were a little bit quicker. They were on the puck first more often. They seem to be alive or have a little more jump or pop than our players did. And if there was one thing I'd be looking for in Game 2, it would be for our forwards to come out with that little extra energy and that little extra zip.
When you come to this level, you don't like to lose. And the next morning you wake up and you think, we lost Game 1 and we'll never be able to get that back. You know, they're a game up on us. And yet the next day, the sun comes up, and you have another fresh approach. And then today I thought we had good jump in practice. The guys are having fun. They're excited about playing again. And in a sense, I think the two days in between games, which we thought was gonna be a detriment, is going to turn in our favor, I believe.
Most important of all, the Canadiens did not want to go back to Montreal down 2-0 in this series. So from the opening draw, as promised, the Habs went right at it, seeking to win all the little battles. But that still didn't mean they could get past Mike Vernon. But 4 minutes into the first period, pressure in the Calgary end pays off.
Canadiens get the draw up the line. Robinson takes a shot.
With his second goal in as many games, six-time Stanley Cup winner Larry Robinson gives Montreal the early lead. That lead carries into the second period as the Habs go on the power play. With the extra man advantage, a rushing Chris Chelios spearheads the attack. But after Smith's power play goal, the Flames dominate the second period, a period in which they put 16 shots on Patrick Roy. That kind of firepower almost always gets results.
McClellan scoops it in wide of the net. Roy put one high on the glass.
Joe Nieuwendyk's 10th playoff goal narrows the margin. Later, a Flames power play offers a chance for more.
Gets it to Fleury. Now McKenna shoots. He pulled it wide. Rebound. Score! We're tied.
Joel Otto's goal evened it as the Canadiens let their lead slip away. That prompted Pat Burns to between period action, as Bobby Smith relates.
Coach took it upon himself to try and do what he could to make the adrenaline flow in the players, and
breaking a couple of sticks and throwing a few things around and knocking over a few garbage cans is not the remedy for every situation, but it was for game two.
In the third period, the Canadians are all business as they try to take advantage of their ability of getting the puck out of their zone.
Try to play it back, as Pelota gets it out to Skrulin. Skrulin pass behind him. Good one for Chalio. Scores! Chalio scores!
Breaking clear in the midst of a line change, Chris Chelios has gotten Montreal the lead back again. It's 3-2 in favor of the Habs. Now Calgary looks to re-gear their attack.
Let's go and get it, guys. Let's go and get it, Mark.
But Gary Roberts' penalty just 12 seconds after Chelios' goal leaves Calgary shorthanded.
At the blue line. Pass to the other side. Now Portnoy coming in. He scores! Portnoy on another beautiful shot. Chrissy Vernon, 4-2 Montreal.
Russ Portnoy's goal gives the Canadians their second power play tally and an insurmountable lead. Though the Flames outshot Montreal 32-23, the Habs were on target in their 4-2 win.
We didn't give Montreal a lot of chances, but again, Montreal don't need a lot of chances. They bury the chances they get, and tonight they proved point in fact that we, you know, in around the 12-14 chance mark, they put four of them in. It's the mark of a good hockey team, and that's why they're in the finals.
With the series even, the scene now shifts back east to the beautiful city of Montreal. Hallowed Montreal Forum, the mecca of hockey, and the place where the Canadians are the focus of attention in a community that enjoys the game with unparalleled passion. In their only regular season visit to the Forum, the Flames were victorious, but that's of little consequence now as both teams strive for an edge coming off of game two.
Especially, you know, after you lose a game, you have to come out next game, you have to put a little more effort into it, you have to, you know, play that much more harder. Maybe more physical, maybe more along the boards, maybe getting the puck out a little harder. You know, whatever it takes, you have to do. And you realize that after you lose that game. You know, when you win a few in a row, you sort of get that feeling, well, you know, we can basically do anything and win. But for us, against Montreal, we know we can't do that.
I'd say we recognize that in Calgary, that they're a good team, and they're not a team that a small crack will turn into a big crack easily. And tonight's game is a good pivotal game. If we can get tonight's game, then we know we have six games for sure, and we know we'll have them back here in the Forum.
They're going to come in here and play aggressive. They're going to do everything they can to win this game. And, you know, a favorite saying Matt's or other guys often say in our dressing room is, let's put our best game on the ice, and then if they beat us, they beat us. But let's not beat ourselves. Let's get our best game out there. Let's not leave our best game in the dressing room.
In those tense and quiet moments before the opening face-off, no one could have expected the drama this game would produce. Not surprisingly, at this point, the first goal again comes rather early.
McPhee coming in with Portnoy and Skrulin. Here's McPhee, shot scores!
Mike McPhee at a minute 32, but the Flames come back later in the first.
More for Calgary, trying to work it in, he does! Right in front of Mullen was covered. Here's the shot.
Joe Mullen delivers an even-strength goal to tie, and in the second period, repeats with one on the power play. Calgary's leading point scorer during the year provides the Flames with a one-goal margin. Later in the third period, the teams exchange goals, and Calgary tries to protect the win as the Habs launch an all-out assault in the dwindling moments of the game. Soon, an empty net bid by Joey Mullen runs wide, and the Canadians desperately head up ice. With only 41 seconds left, Mats Naslund has tied the game at 3. Montreal's last-minute magic means overtime. After the intermission, Patrick Waugh steals himself for the ordeal ahead as the Flames are reminded of the necessary adjustments when playing in overtime.
On net. Come back hard, down hard. 35, 40 seconds and off.
And so begins what will turn out to be nearly two full periods of sudden-death Stanley Cup hockey. The tension and effort are extreme. In the 17th minute of the second overtime, a critical event takes place. As Montreal's Shane Corson plays the puck along the boards, Mark Hunter delivers a hit and is called for boarding, setting up the first and only power play in overtime. The Flames are stunned, and the Canadiens eager to take advantage.
Don't stay away from the scoring area, guys! Stay in that scoring area!
The Canadiens had failed on six previous power plays, and technically they were unsuccessful on this one. But just before the penalty end, Stéphane Richer makes the big play.
Richer steals it, comes in. Richer around the net. Score! The Canadiens win the game in second overtime.
A hard loss for the Flames to take, but a great win for Montreal. The score sheet reads that at 18:08 of second overtime, Ryan Walter ended the second longest game in NHL history played in the Stanley Cup Finals. Here's his description of what happened.
Stefan did most of the work, and he got the puck along the boards. I think everybody thought he was going to go behind the net and try to stuff it. He's done that before. And he stopped, came short side, and just sort of popped it over Mike Vernon's stick. And I don't know why I was there. I just came through the slot and I just sort of banged at it and it went between his legs.
For the Flames, it was necessary to accept the loss and move on. A pivotal fourth game lay ahead. For both teams, game three was now history.
I think that the guys were really upset at the moment we got the penalty and the game was over. But we're going to take that energy and focus it tonight. You know, take that frustration and use it tonight as positive energy for us.
We have a chance to put them behind by a distance, to give them, put in their minds that they're facing elimination, that they have a great, great mountain to climb to get back into the series. And I think they'll be in the forum tonight to play the game of their lives. And we have to understand that and be prepared for it.
I don't think it's crucial that we score first, but it is crucial that we maintain a good mindset and make sure that our play is up to our potential for especially the opening of the hockey game.
Though the Flames had come out blazing in Game 4, outshooting the Habs 13-3, they had failed to score. And midway in the second, Doug Gilmore was serving a penalty. That unexpectedly led to the game's first goal.
15 seconds left on the penalty. And Smith is stopped in his tracks at the blue line. Down the ice again. That will do it on the penalty. Gilmore gets ready to come back on. He is now on the ice. Penalty over. Smith coming out for Montreal. A pass intercepted. Gilmore is going in all alone. He scores! Gilmore! Calgary leads 1-0.
Gilmore came out of the penalty box, intercepted the pass, and then he showed you why he's a premier player.
7 minutes later, Larry Robinson is penalized for cross-checking. And for Calgary, opportunity is knocking at the door again.
McInnes again. Into the corner it goes. Otto back to the net. To Mullen. On the other side. Mullen to McInnes. Winding up. Shoots. It's the score. Mullen got the rebound. On the McInnes shot. It was stopped. A power play goal for Calgary here.
The Flames' 2-0 lead carries into the third period, but just past the midway mark, the Canadiens draw to within one on a goal by Russ Courtnall. Calgary must now protect a one-goal lead as the Habs again try to follow through on another comeback.
Fleury coming to center. He is stopped. Pass ahead to Courtnall in the trail.
Oh, no.
Oh, and a save by Vernon.
In the waning minutes of this 2-1 game, each team is aware of how critical a mistake could be. Mike Vernon's job is made easier by the fact that Calgary is putting 13 third-period shots on Patrick Waugh. And with less than 2 minutes left, on comes Al MacInnis, who earlier this night set a record for defensemen by scoring in his 15th straight playoff game.
He's in! Scores!
Al MacInnis's booming slap shot puts the Flames up 3-1 with just a minute 38 remaining. But true to the form already displayed in the finals, this game is far from over as Montreal presses in.
30 seconds to play. Robinson again with a shot. Ooh. Rebound! They score!
Claude Lemieux's goal makes it 3-2, but in a post-goal scrum, Lemieux draws a slashing penalty, and that nullifies the man advantage Montreal gained by pulling Patrick Waugh. Now at even strength, and with an empty net ahead, Joe Mullen bears in on his playoff-leading 15th goal. Final score, 4-2. Calgary has beaten Montreal. It's a huge win for the Flames, coming back from the adversity of Game 3 to even the series. Now both teams are on the road back to Calgary.
Let's go, guys.
It's back to the Olympic Saddle Dome, back to the West. With the finals now boiled down to a best 2 out of 3, the Canadians work on certain aspects of their game. They've had the opportunity through 2 wins and 2 losses to learn what makes Calgary tick.
I think one of the things that's happened in this series, as happens in all long series, is there are adjustments and counter-adjustments. And I think the Flames are really forcing us in our zone. Sometimes they've got 5 men well in over the blue line. And I think maybe a couple of long passes, either to spring a guy or to almost spring a guy, is going to force them to back up a little bit and give us a little bit more freedom to come out of our zone properly, because your offensive attack starts by how well and how cohesively you cross your own blue line.
The Flames, for their part, are coming off Game 4's win and are generally pleased with their approach. They're also aware that throughout the season, they had the best home record in hockey.
You don't come in at this time of the year and wave a magic wand and say, okay, we're going to go from this style to this style. Because all you do is have confusion and mayhem in your camp, and the guys say, well, what's wrong with what we're doing? It's successful. We're here. Let's keep doing it. All you do is fine-tune it.
Hockey weather on game day in Calgary, but both teams are more concerned about the climate inside the Olympic Saddle Dome, in the static, charged atmosphere of play that develops from the opening draw.
You know, for us to win Game 5, we need to put a total effort together. We have to come out right from the start, right from the first drop of the puck, and work hard and keep forcing them, keep pressuring them.
That thinking holds true as, once again, a goal comes early.
Canadians get the puck out into the center ice area. McPhee lost the chance for the lead.
Just 28 seconds into the game, a goal from Joel Otto. Calgary jumps on the unlikely occurrence of the puck slipping past Rick Green. Waugh stops the first shot, but not the rebound. And now Calgary looks to build on that lead. At the 8-minute mark, the Flames are finishing up a power play, bearing down on the Montreal goal.
Here's the shot.
With his 5th goal in 3 games, Joey Mullen has put Calgary out in front 2-0. The Canadians desperately need to get on track, and they take a step in that direction as they snap an 0-for-13 streak on the power play. Bobby Smith works home a rebound, and the score is 2-1. But Al MacInnis soon strikes again, launching another fearsome slap shot on a Flames power play. The result has become predictable. MacInnis's 7th goal and playoff-leading 29th point has Calgary back up by 2 just before the end of the first period. Once again, Montreal must play catch-up.
Let's go! Up and in! Up and in! Come on!
Late in the second period, the Canadians start to click as Bobby Smith's shuttle pass is played by Mike Keane for a score. Now, with the score 3-2, the Canadians continue their charge in the third period, going right at the Calgary net.
The Canadians keep the pressure on. The Leafs head dumping it in. And a quick shot in front of the net. Right up this man, allowing Trudeau to come in. Charlie goes to the middle. Oh! And up just makes the bar close.
Near the end, the Flames still lead 3-2.
Discipline! 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 Discipline!
Keep that emotion going there.
With the goaltender pulled and a sixth skater on the ice, the Canadiens' last chance ends as the net comes off its moorings. Montreal, despite a gallant third period, can do little more at this point except vent its frustrations. This game is finished, and Calgary has won it 3-2. For the first time in the 17-year history of the franchise, the Flames were just one win away from the Stanley Cup championship. When speaking of the Stanley Cup, the Montreal Forum is emblematic. There hang the banners representing a record 23 championships. And before Game 6, the Habs were reminded that no Canadiens club had ever lost a cup-deciding game on Forum ice. But that was then, and this is now, and both sides discounted the impact of the past.
Well, everybody's looking for an edge, and I think that Forum mystique is a prime example of that. Montreal doesn't have a lot of players left that were here in 1924.
We cannot have Maurice Richard come in and dress with us tonight. We'd love to have him in the power play, but it's just impossible. He's not here. He's not on our team.
But the Montreal Canadiens do have 15 men on their roster who all have at least one Stanley Cup ring in their possession. In stark contrast were the Flames. Not one of them had ever known the joy of winning the Cup. In fact, for one of their captains, Lanny McDonald, the Cup had become the focal point of a 16-year crusade. Now more than ever, the Grail was in sight, and both teams felt the pressure on game day.
It's pretty nerve-wracking, really. It's exciting. It's tough to get a little sleep. It's tough to really keep your mind on everything that's going on.
But I'm trying to hold back a little bit now because I feel pumped already, and the game's not for a couple more hours.
Stomach will be in knots. I won't be able to sleep. I'll be going over situations in my mind. I'll think about the game. I'll try and get it out of my mind.
Emotionally, it'll be charged tonight when the game starts. There'll be a lot of emotion in the game. And, I mean, the situation is very clear. We have to win.
In the moments before Game 6, a certain stillness and calm as every player seeks the strength within. That calm will soon be ended by a game with a championship on the line. Came out in a fury, but Mike Vernon withstood the early charge. Back and forth, the two teams jockeyed for control.
Don't send it back to the side, guys.
Be on the puck, guys. Be on it. Just keep it going deep. Be on it.
Finally, after 18 minutes, someone breaks through.
Here's Patterson with a chance. He scores. Patterson stopping the puck at the line. He went in to score on Raw and the Calgary Flames. Draw first blood and lead 1-0.
Patterson's goal not only puts Calgary up, but quiets the Montreal crowd as well. But early in the second period, the Forum fans have reason to cheer. Claude Lemieux from the right side, and his shot climbs past Vernon for the goal. The score is tied 1-1. Lemieux's goal gives Montreal new life, and in a game of momentum and surges, it appears that Montreal might be on the rise. But less than 3 minutes later, Calgary finds a way to respond as Lanny McDonald gets ready to join the play. McDonald had been a role player this year, but now his role was at center stage.
At center and coming in as Lou Hewendike centered it. McDonald scores! Lanny McDonald!
Lanny McDonald, 500 goals in his career, and he just scored the greatest.
Shut him down out there.
And so with a 2-1 lead, the Flames settle into a careful game, engulfing Montreal in a sea of red defense, a defense which had played so effectively throughout the final. While Montreal is held in check, the Flames wait to attack. And in the third period on the power play, Doug Gilmore finds the right time as he follows up his own rebound for the score. Calgary now leads 3-1 thanks to Gilmore's 10th playoff goal. And with less than 9 minutes remaining, time is running out on Montreal. Sure enough, the Canadians heed the call, and quickly at that, making this old building roar.
Now, Green gets set, shoots, scores! Green!
Defenseman Rick Green's second goal of the year suggests that there may yet be time for a Montreal miracle. But as the ensuing minutes slip away, Calgary clings to its 3-2 lead. Finally, the Habs are forced to pull their goaltender, and Calgary is ready to seize the moment.
Gilmore has a shot to win it all here. He scores! Gilmore scores! Calgary leads 4-2. 5 seconds after Patrick Roy got to the Montreal bench.
Now it is over. Montreal's 24th Stanley Cup has been denied. This is Calgary's time. This is Calgary's celebration. This is Calgary Stanley Cup Championship. Having played a series that was as great as its promise, the Calgary Flames finally let loose. Both teams showed winning class, but only one can delight in the unrestrained joy of the moment. For Lanny McDonald, a long-awaited championship. For Al MacInnis, the Conn Smythe Trophy is the playoffs' most valuable player. And for all the Flames, the Stanley Cup, hoisted high by the captains. A pleasure soon to be shared by one and all. The franchise that began in Atlanta 17 years ago has finally come to its full greatness in Calgary. The Sea of Red is now a sea of champions.
Lots of character in this dressing room.
Take that, boys! Take that!
And we're number one.
Woo! Behind me, behind there! Woo!
It's something you dream about since you've been this high. But I've always been this high, so you know.
I said to my wife before the game, if I had a chance to play, I scored my first goal ever in the Montreal Forum. It would be a great way to end it, to score and make a difference in the final game. It really is a dream come true.
This is it. This is a pinnacle of, you know, of a career right here. Hopefully it'll happen again.
I think I'll ride with it on the way home to Calgary, where it belongs.
When he got run behind the net tonight, and you know what you did?
I didn't hit him back.
That's right. Went back in the crease and let it go. That told me we were in business. We were going to win it.
I'm glad this is on camera. That's all I got to say.
Well, after 16 years of waiting to next year, you know, it's a great feeling that next year finally arrived.
All the talk before the series was the Montreal Canadiens and the history and all the cups. But we come right in here and we made history tonight here, boy.
Tonight's the night we'll make history. Honey, you and I. 'Cause I'll take any risk to tie back the hands of time and stay with you here tonight.
For Calgary, the road to the Stanley Cup was not an easy one. Along the way, there were many who hoped the flame would flicker. But this team was unrelenting in the pursuit of its dream. In 1989, the Calgary Flames passed through the lonely fires of adversity. Theirs was the triumph of champions.
The headlines read, these are the worst of times. I do believe. I feel so helpless, like a boat against.